I am really excited to share this week's tutorial with you because it's a project that I'm currently working on right now. And I think this workflow is extremely applicable to almost every designer out there. We don't have enough time and resources like floor plans or models to work with. This process is extremely effective at communicating ideas and concepts along with a beautiful drawing to show in a presentation. So what does this workflow look like? Well, it all started with a visit to the client's house. So be prepared to bring in a camera with you, or if you have a capable smartphone, that should work as well. A part of this project is the kitchen remodel, which has this really outdated style with cabinets, counters, and a color scheme that was really like 20 to 30 years ago. Part of the challenge was the client didn't have any existing drawings of any sort, not even one of those, you know, simplified real estate floor plans that you see on a brochure or written. So at this point in the project, there's not enough incentive for the client to hire a as-built vendor to document the entire house. But given this is what I had to work with, I took some really good photograph of the space and just sketched over my initial proposition right over it, like someone would with trace paper, except I did this on the iPad, which I also brought with me during the site walk to take notes from it. So if this is your first time on my channel, my name is Henry, and I share drawing and design tips to help architects and interior designers with a digital workflow. I'm using an app called Procreate on my 12.9-inch iPad Pro. The goal for this remodel is to substantially elevate its current look without changing the existing layout in a very cost-effective way. So this meant all the appliances need to stay where they are, same with the cabinet frames, except some can be deleted without building new ones. And there can be a lot of cosmetic changes to the tile, counter, hardware, fixture, lighting, and other things that are easy to upgrade. My end goal for this initial meeting is just to have a conversation about my ideas, show them some reference images, a mood board, possibly some materials to get them excited. This is definitely not a final design, but it's enough to have a productive conversation on next steps. So that was kind of a lengthier intro than normal. Let's get into the drawing workflow process, which I've broken down into four parts: the design phase, the drawing phase, the coloring phase, and final touches. I took many photos of the kitchen, but the photo I chose to work with shows all the areas that I want to change without crazy distortion. So keep this in mind when you're trying to pick a view. If I could draw less to communicate the same amount of information, then I'm going to do that instead of producing multiple views to show the same thing. I wanted to replace the really ugly fluorescent lights in the ceiling with skylights, which is going to bring ample amount of daylight into the space. And since the entire roof needs to be reconstructed anyways, because it was recently damaged by a tree, there is a lot of latitude for new electrical work, framing, and finishes. There are also a lot of closed off upper cabinets in the space, which I thought were too much and too heavy. If selectively removed, they could make room to become floating shelves, which would make the space feel a lot lighter and more dynamic. And all this is quick and relatively inexpensive to do. The style of the cabinets, the trim, the color are pretty outdated. So the easiest thing would just to repaint them to a different color, but it would be so much nicer if only the doors were to be replaced with new shaker style doors, which the owner actually really likes. And we can also install nicer hardware and a fresh coat of paint. And all this is going to drastically change the feel of it. There's also new plumbing fixture, lighting fixture, kitchen backsplash, and new counters that we can do to completely transform the space along with a new hardwood floor. So in the drawing, I'm also thinking about compositionally, how do I want to portray this with decors and interior entourage that can humanize the space so the entire scene doesn't feel so sterile? I can easily draw in plates and glasses on the floating shelf, things on the island, and maybe a dish towel next to the sink, which will all add to the human component to the story. Once you've thought through all these things and you have them traced out on a layer on the iPad, now you can begin the drawing portion. And I think the more prepared you are before drawing, the easier and faster you can finish the drawing. But this isn't to say you have to work out all the designs. The beauty of drawing on the iPad instead of paper is you have total flexibility to fix, revise, jump back and forth whenever you want. In the drawing phase, I'm not going to go through all the technical steps because I think you can glean it from my other videos, so I'll just summarize some of the important concepts to remember. First, make use of your layers and think of them as trace paper to put different information on different layers, which is going to make your life so much easier when it comes down to editing. Secondly, choose whether you want to freehand the drawing or use straight line in the perspective as a style. There are advantages to both. With freehand, I think you can be a little looser with your perspective, so it's quicker for some things. But if you want more accuracy, you can use the perspective guides in the drawing assist menu, find your vanishing points, and build your perspective with more accuracy. You can see a more detailed workflow in this tutorial above. Secondly, get used to drawing quickly and don't overthink or try to be a perfectionist. Occasionally in the video, you'll see me stumble and redraw a line a couple of times, but I try to minimize this unless I really, you know, screw things up. In the real world, time is your most important resource, so the faster you can put your thoughts to paper, the better place you will find yourself in. And with the digital workflow, you can always come back later to iterate and edit. And lastly, if you're wondering what brushes I'm using for inking and coloring in this tutorial, you can find them in the description below. I don't use a lot of brushes, but the felt pen and the Copic marker brush are definitely my go-to and produces 90% of my drawings. As a side note, I also recently picked up this Apple Pencil sleeve on Amazon. And I initially got this because I kept dropping my pencil on the floor and I was afraid of breaking it. But as a side benefit, this sleeve gives you so much more grip than holding the Apple Pencil, which is both too skinny and slippery in my opinion. When you are finished with a drawing, please take a little break for your hands and fingers because they deserve it, and come back later after a stretch. In coloring, I want you to remember a couple of principles. First, picking the right color or swatch right from the beginning isn't as important as compared to like an analog workflow. This is only because you have the ability to adjust the hue, saturation, brightness in Procreate. It's more important you understand when to assign colors to different layers based on their importance or materiality. You want to make it as easy for yourself to individually tweak colors without affecting colors that you don't want to change. But this doesn't mean you have to create so many layers to every color you use. So use some common sense and discretion. As an option, when you have multiple colors on one layer, you can use the selection tool to select a localized area and adjust the color in that spot. And if you want to see how I organize my colors, you can download many of my study samples in the link below as well. And just open it up and see it for yourself. Sequence-wise, I like to start coloring with the bigger surface first. And in this case, it's the cabinets, the wood on the ceiling, and the floor. Then I'll gradually work towards two smaller areas like the kitchen counter, the tile on the backsplash, and appliances. Ultimately, I will work on even smaller details such as the decor, hardware, and fixtures. As a tip, you don't always have to color everything inside the lines. And what I mean by this is when you create a new layer to color, this will mask whatever color is on the layer below. So in a way, you're kind of erasing the mistakes below if you color outside of the lines. Now, picking colors is totally up to you. I like to use the earthy and muted color palette, even if the real material doesn't reflect it. I want you to be mindful when you're picking swatches because colors do play a role in how someone might react to the design. And usually at this point, I prefer not to call out so much attention to the materiality. I think it's more important for me to talk about the overall vibe, the tonal quality, you know, the light and the dark contrast instead of portraying the exact material specification. At this point, I'm 90% done and I will usually take another break before coming back to add any finishing touches. And when my eyeballs had enough break, I will usually see something I don't like. Either it's the way I drew something or it's something about the design that I want to change. And this can actually go on for a couple of days when a new or even a better idea that might emerge. In this drawing, I took the time to group and rename my layers. So when I come back to it later, it's easy to identify what's what. And if you've created too many layers, Also take this time to organize your layer by merging or grouping. I also added some additional texture to the wood ceiling and floors to give it additional depth. And I did this with a slightly thinner line weight. The kitchen backsplash also received some embellishment because I wanted to make it read with more variation in color and texture, almost like a handcraft tile. Lastly, I tried something new with the lighting. I wanted to communicate the effect of the skylight in the ceiling because I know it's such a wonderful element that can really bring a lot of change to the existing space. But I wasn't sure how this would work initially, so I started drawing some light rays coming from above with white stroke and experimented putting it on different blending mode. I ended up putting it on luminosity as it looked the most natural. And I erased the part of the light rays at the bottom so it blended in with the scene a little better. So all in all, from beginning to end, the sketch from concept to finish took about 2 hours of drawing time as it was recorded. But it didn't include time to rest, to edit, and to research for better ideas. Keep in mind the purpose of the sketch is to imagine what the space could be without investing too much time. It also needed to engage the client in a productive conversation and move the design further along into technical drawings and specifications. So I really want to hear from you guys. What do you think of this approach? Are there significant downfalls that you can observe? And would you adopt this into your own workflow? Any thoughts would be appreciated down below. Thank you, and I will see you in the next video.